So welcome everyone back to the class on AGDL. Right, so in the last class we were dealing about pentagonal pyramid related to how to solve the problems for beta angle as well as for inclination of the given solid object with respect to edges and corners, right? So we have solved all the varieties and we have shared the links also in your Google Classroom. I have posted the assignment questions in the Google Classroom with the due dates. Kindly submit at the earliest. We have very few days in hand to finalize your IA marks. It was done long back, even the square pyramid and the pentagonal. Some people have not uploaded yet. So you see that you upload at the earliest so that I can evaluate the marks for the problems which was posted in the classroom. Okay, so now let us start with pentagonal pyramid problems. So we are going in hand both the regular problems as well as the beta angle problems. So after this, we will be focusing on slant edge problems related to square, pentagon, hexagon, pyramid, and then we'll solve one problem on resolution of this one objects, which is related to our cone problems at the end. So let us start with today's activity related to our pentagonal hexagonal pyramid. I will just share my screen 2 seconds. Is the screen visible to you all? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So today we'll be dealing with hexagonal pyramid problems. So everyone know how does an hexagonal pyramid looks like? We have covered that in our concept class. So, but still for your reference, a hexagonal pyramid will be having a base surface, which will be having 6 sides and hence called the hexagon. And it will be bounded by 6 triangular surfaces, which will be joined at a common point, what we call it as apex. So you will be having an bottom surface and the apex, which is bounded by 6 triangular surfaces. So related to the problem, how it's been resting, whether it is resting on one of its edge or one of its corner, you should align the initial position of the given solid. So if you go wrong in the initial position, you won't be getting marks for the further stages. So you have to very be keen in identifying the initial position. So we are now starting with the first problem on hexagonal pyramid. So here you can look the question where I have typed here as well. So it is an hexagonal pyramid of 25 mm side of base. So the base has all the sides equal to 25 mm. Is my web on? No. Yeah. Fine. So this is a hexagonal prism. So where it is being told the side is equal to 25 mm. So all the sides of the given hexagonal prism will be equal to 25 mm. And it is told that the axis height is 50 mm. So you know that even in pyramid, similar to prism, you'll be having the top center and the bottom center. So the axis of the center line, which is passing through our given hexagonal pyramid here, is about 50 mm. So this is the given data about the hexagonal pyramid. And next you have to see how it has been placed. So it is told that it is resting on one of its edges of the base, and the same edge of the base is inclined to BP. So VP inclination will be focusing on the large stage. So irrespective of whether it's a prism, yeah, pyramid or solids of revolution, always I have told you the norms. In the first stage, we assume the axis to be perpendicular, and in the second stage, inclined to HP, and in the third stage, inclination with respect to VP. So these inclination with respect to VP could be related to the edges or the axis. If it is in the case of axis, then we have to determine the apparent angle. If it is the axis inclination, if it is told appears to be, then we won't determine the apparent angle because it looks as though it is appearing to VP at particular angle. Okay, so these are the three varieties what we have to deal with. So currently we are focusing on the problem resting on one of its edge. So now you know that we will be having the horizontal plane and the vertical plane. So the given problem is told it is resting on one of its edge. So when it is told resting on one of its edge, you have to place one of the edge of the given solid towards your right. Okay, so any one edge of the given base hexagonal pyramid. So you just keep it towards your right. So when you keep one of your edge towards your right, obviously you'll be having the other opposite edge parallel to it towards your left. Okay, so this will be the regular hexagonal position. How does it look when it is resting on one of its edge? You should not tilt towards the corner. Okay, if it is case where the given pyramid is resting on one of its corner, then you have to keep the corner towards your right. Since it is the edge, please focus the edge towards your right. So if you have kept properly, you will get the opposite edge parallel where you have been resting in the opposite end. So this will be the regular hexagonal prism. So you can see in the screen also, you will be resting one of its edge towards your right so that the opposite edge will be lying towards your left. And it will not be resting on the corner since it is a problem in which it is told it is resting on one of its edge. Okay, so in that case, after positioning, if you view from the top, what you will be able to see, you'll be able to see the true shape of the base of the given hexagonal pyramid. And hence here, you can see the true shape of the given hexagonal pyramid, right? So once your top view is over, then you have to look from the front. So any pyramid for that matter, when you look from the front, you will be seeing a triangular surface. Why? It is bounded by the triangular surface. So when you view from the front, you can see the projection from this edge, and the projection from this longer edge. We won't be able to visualize the axis when it is resting on one of its edge. Why? Because the axis line will be overlapped here with one of the longer edge. And hence you can see here in the front view, you are not showing the axis line, but it is a continuous visible line. What we show through the projection of this longer edge, and hence in the front view you will be having an triangular surface. And naming, you are aware already, for bottom surface we do name it as A, B, C, D, E and F. In case of prism, we used to have the top surface as well as the bottom. So we used to write which is visible outside the bracket, which is not visible within the bracket. But in case of pyramid, that is not the case. We'll be having only one surface. So we'll just name that as A, B, C, D, E, and F for the top view. And similarly, when you view from the front, you have the triangular surface. So we will name it accordingly. So let us start up with the first stage. So you now know you have to start up with our top view, right? So top view will be a regular hexagon, which is resting on one of its edge. So how do you construct an hexagon? We have done even that in our construction work, but still you can just draw an horizontal reference line. Okay, or then you just take here the side, or you take 45 degree here and 45 degree here. So if you draw a line, I'll just show you. Okay, for your purpose, you can just draw a straight line. So after drawing the straight line, you will just take 45 degree here and 45 degree here. So the angle between these two will be 45. Okay, so that the interior here you will be getting 120 degree. Okay, so this is our 120 plus 60. So totally you will be this entire is 120, 180. So this angle will be our 120. So if you come to our right angle triangle here, so this will be 60. Okay. So first what you do is you will just draw a line, take 45 degree here and 45 degree here, and then you measure what is the distance exactly. It is given as 25 mm. So using the compass, keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc for 25 mm. And similarly here, cut an arc for 25 mm. So we got the two sides. So after here, you will just project it straight vertically. So if you feel this way of construction is difficult, so you can do it in the other way also. For that, no need of drawing the straight line. You can just draw a vertical line here first. I think this will be comfortable for you all. Just go with this method only. Since it is resting on one of its edge, right? First draw the edge which has been resting. So please draw an horizontal line over here and measure 25 mm. So this you will do it. After here, just take the interior angle of 120 degree. So from the straight line, keep the protractor here and take 120 degree. And even from here, please take the protractor and take 120 degree. After that, use the compass, measure 25 mm and cut an arc. And here also use the compass, measure 25 mm and you just cut an arc. Okay, so if you have constructed properly, you can see these two corners coming along the same line. So after you get these two corners, again keep the protractor here and take 120 degree this side. And again this interior angle should be 120 degree. Okay, so after taking 120 degree, you will take 25 mm using the compass, cut an arc. 25 mm from here, cut an arc. So you got all the corners, please join it. And always this will be visible. This is the true shape of the top view. Kindly darken it. So once you darken it, for each solid, you need to join the diagonals to identify the center. So you will join all the diagonals and identify the center over here. You know that you have the top center and the bottom. So when you view from the top, the center O will be visible, whereas O1 of the bottom surface will not be visible. So O1 you will write it within the bracket and O outside the bracket. And for other corners, you will name accordingly A, B, C, D, E and F. And many times you forget to show the dimensioning part. Even in the sketch problems what you're sending me, many people forget to show the dimensions. When you're drawing, you don't show a rough arrow. Please draw it properly. Very few students are maintaining the arrow dimensions, everything as per the norms. Please draw arrows properly. Use very light line for projection and show the dimension of it as 25. So once you're done with the top view, then please go ahead with the question. So it is told that axis height is of about 50 mm. So here we cannot show the center line because the center line is overlapped with the projection of this longer edge. And hence we will draw a continuous thick line. So from here you just project using very light thin line. From there you project it above with a continuous thick line. See the dimension for the axis, it is 50. So you can directly use the scale and measure 50 mm or you can use the compass, keep one end of the compass here, measure 50 mm and cut an arc. So you'll get the dimension for the axis height, which is of 50 mm. So after doing this, you have taken the projection from these corner and these corner also, right? So from this end, you will join to the apex. From this end, you will join to the apex. So that will give you the front view. So please darken that immediately. So once you do the darkening part, next you have to give the naming for it. So how do you do? Again, your observer will be here. So when the observer views from here, C and D is falling along the same line. But when he views from here, C will be visible and D won't be visible. So here in our front view, you will write it as C dash and D dash. And again, when the observer views from here, B and E is along the same line, right? So when he views from here, B will be visible and E will be eaten. So you will write B dash outside the bracket and E dash within the bracket. Along with it, you have the center O1 passing along the same line. Even that will not be visible. So you will write it that in the bracket as O1 dash. So once you have completed this end, now we will go for the last corner. So here we have A and F coming along the same line. So when the observer views from here, A will be visible and F won't be visible. So you will write it here as A dash, and in the bracket you will write it as F dash. And similarly, we have the center at the apex as O. So in the front view, it becomes O dash. So once the naming is done, please don't forget to show the dimension of the axis. So it is exactly 50 mm. So please draw the arrows properly, write the numerical font size, let it be clearly visible. Don't draw it very congested way, okay? So everything what you draw should be very neat, clean, readable, and the views have to be darkened. So by looking only, we should able to understand that you have done everything with respect to the norms. If you crash, if you rub and do something complicated thing, so we cannot see exactly how clear your sketches are. So maintain cleanliness also while solving the problems. So once the stage one is done, don't start the stage two very near. Leave some convenient place, okay? Then start up with the stage two. So you know that in the stage two, always we take the inclination of HP first. Right, so now go for the data related to the inclination of HP. So here it is given, the axis is inclined to HP at 45 degrees. So what you do now is, first you leave some space and draw an axis line. Don't show the center line here. Again, a longer continuous edge only we are projecting. So it is a continuous thick line. So you will take 45 degree to HP. So once you take 45 degree to HP, you have to shift now the base, which was exactly parallel to XY line, to inclination of HP at 45. So for that, you should identify the distance from the center, sorry, O1 dash to A1 dash, how much it is. So please measure the distance using compass. Okay, don't do this with respect to the scale. Please measure this distance in the compass and just move on this 45 degree line, such that the other edge touches the XY line. Okay, so if you keep this distance over here, so it will come below XY line, right? So you have to move on XY line until and unless it cuts exactly on XY line. So you'll be having this reference point and where it has cut the XY plane. So please join this base part immediately. So once you draw this base half the part, kindly extend the same line towards your back end also. So this line should be exactly perpendicular to our 45 degree axis line. Okay. So then that shows that you have constructed properly. If you have an inclined baseline, then it is not the right way to construct. So you might go wrong in identifying the position from where you have cut the arc. So be careful. Take this distance, move on the XY line so accurately, such that the line what you construct will be exactly perpendicular to our axis line. So after you extend the baseline over here, then what you do is, you have to now measure the remaining distance. So from O1 dash to C1 dash, so you will see what is the distance is using the compass. Come back over here, keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc on the baseline what you have drawn. So now we got our base. So please darken it immediately. So after darkening it, we have our 45 degree line. So on this 45 degree line, you kindly measure this 50 mm because our axis height is 50 mm. So please measure 50 mm. Using the compass, come back over here and just cut an arc. So where it meets will be our apex O dash. So once you name A O dash, then you can join these two corners of the base. So from here to here you will join, and from here to here also you will join. So once you join, kindly do the naming as shown in the first stage of our front view. So this corner is our C dash and D dash, and this corner is our A dash and F dash. So at the center axis, we have O1 dash as well as B dash and E dash. So please write this accordingly. So now here we have the apex O dash, what we have written already. So this completes the second stage front view. So after doing this, as usual, we will take the projection down. So projection from C dash and D dash, projection from B dash, E dash, projection from A dash, F dash, and also take the projection from O dash. Let it be very light line. Don't show a thicker line. Some students are showing the projection line thickness and XY line thickness similarly darkened. Please don't do it. The projection line should be thinner than our XY line. Okay, so then after you take the projections down, kindly take the projections from our top view also. So projection, you just project from E. If you have constructed properly, D and F will come along the same line. C and A will come along the same line. And then extend the projection of B as well as projection of E. After drawing the projections, so now please read the locus. So here you have locus of A. So locus of A is meeting A dash at this point. So this will be our point A. And then locus of B is meeting B dash at this point. So this is our point B. Locus of C is meeting C dash at this point. So this is our point C. Locus of D is meeting D dash at this point. This is our point D. Locus of E is meeting E dash at this point. So this is our E. So we name just the bottom surface of the given hexagonal pyramid. Apart from that, we need to join to the apex. So please read the projection from O1 and O also. So if you extend the projection from O1, you see here the locus of O1 is meeting O1 dash at this point. So this is our O1. The locus of O is meeting O dash at this point. So this is our O. And I have told you the given pyramid. So when it initially we assume that the axis is perpendicular and now it has been tilted for an 45 degrees. So this is our apex and this is the bottom surface. So if this is inclined to our XY line in this position, so one of the corner of the base is being on XY line as shown in our second stage front view. So when the observer views from here, the outer body of the given solid prism will be always visible, like in similar to the other solid objects. So outer boundary we will first join. Okay, so we have the outer boundaries. Use a dark pencil and darken it immediately. So which is our outer boundary? So from the apex, right? You can start from A to B, B to C, C to D, D to E, E to F, F to O. So this is the outer boundary of the given solid surface, right? Which will be visible. So that we will darken it, right? So after this, you can see that we have now covered the outer boundary. So now we have to identify which are the hidden lines. So here we can see we have one corner on XY line. So which is A dash and F dash. So the projection coming through that corner, which is on XY line, will be hidden. So this edge, we will make it hidden. So F to A will be hidden. So the projections which is coming through the hidden line also will be hidden only. I told you when it has been inclined in this position, when the observer views from here, the three edges will not be visible. 1, 2, and 3. So this one, this part of the edge and this part of the edge. So these three edges are here now hidden. Okay, so projection coming through the hidden side will be hidden. So you will join from F to E as hidden and from A to B as the hidden line. So three sides of the base surface is visible and the other three sides of the base surface is hidden. So apart from that, we have to now join the triangular surfaces to our apex, right? And again, I told you the projections which is coming through the corner of the surface, corner of the base surface will be always visible. And the projections coming through the corner from the inside the surface will be hidden. So this is the corner and this is the outer edge of the triangular surface. So you will join this as continuous line. D to O, you will join as continuous line. C to O, you will join as continuous line. Right. Apart from that, E to O is also outer boundary, what we have joined already. B to O is also outer boundary, we have joined already. Right. So you should draw in such a way that the edge here is almost nearer to the longer edge, but still you should show the projection of the hidden line clearly visible. Okay, so this edge will be hidden, this will be hidden, and this will be hidden. Okay, that you have to show. So once you complete the second stage of the top view, so now we have to come for the third stage. So what is being told in the third stage, we usually take the inclination with respect to VP. So what is being told here, you have to see whether the inclination to VP is with respect to edge or with respect to axis. If it is with respect to edge inclination, the true shape, the true length of the edge in the first stage and the second stage will be the same. So no need of determining the apparent angle. If it is inclined, if the given problem in which the axis is inclined to VP, then you can get the true length only in the first stage, and in the second stage you will be having only the apparent length. So in that case we need to determine the apparent angle. But here you can see in the given question, it is the edge of the base which is inclined to VP at 30 degree. So it is the same edge in which it was resting on HP also, right? So the same edge which was resting on HP has to be inclined to our VP. Since the true length of both the cases are the same, we won't determine the apparent angle. Only thing is, you can take 30 degree directly from XY line. If you feel you don't have space enough to construct, you can leave some space and just draw a line parallel to our XY plane, XY line, and from there you can take 30 degree. So both will yield you with the same result. Okay, so always it's better if you draw a line parallel to XY line and from there you draw the 30 degree line. So once you take the 30 degree line, so now you have to fix one of the edges, one of the corner, either F or A. So usually we have fixed the corner here of F. So once you fix the corner F, you please measure this distance from F to A, how much it is. After measuring this distance, come back over here and just cut an arc. Okay, so where it cuts an arc on 30 degree line, you will get the other corner of the base surface, which is our A. So now we got F and A, but this F and A is the hidden side of the given hexagonal pyramid. So don't make this a continuous line, just make it a hidden line. So once this side has been obtained, we need to construct the remaining part of the given solid, right? So what you do is, after getting this side, so now you try to construct the remaining part of the bottom surface first. So you know, once you get this, so kindly name this as F and A. So after naming F and A, you can see that you have the other corner parallel to F and other corner here parallel to A corner, right? So what we do is, we'll just draw a perpendicular line. Right, so from this F, you can just draw a perpendicular line as I've shown you. And similarly, from A also, draw a perpendicular line. So this perpendicular line, construction line, you'll just draw perpendicular line to this 30 degree, okay, 30 degree line. So after drawing this perpendicular line from each point, you can now measure the distance from F to D, how much it is. So please measure the distance F to D, how much it is, and come back at this reference point F and cut an arc. Both the distance will be the same, or else again you can measure the distance from A to C, how much it is, using the compass. Again, come back, keep one end of the compass here and cut an arc. So now you got the other two corners. So name it immediately, or else you'll get confused. So this is D and this is C. So now you got four corners. So two more corners are yet to obtain, right? So for that, what you do is you have F and A. So kindly identify the midpoint here between F and A. So this is F and this is A. So you measure from F to this midpoint, what is the distance? Come back here and just make a reference point. Okay, so this is the midpoint. So from midpoint also, you just draw a perpendicular line. Okay, this is the midpoint. You can just draw a perpendicular line from this 30-degree line. Okay, so after that, you will measure from the midpoint to the center what is the distance using the compass. So please measure the distance, come back to this midpoint and just cut an arc on the perpendicular line what you have drawn so that we will get our center O1. So once you get the center O1, you will be having all these three points along the same line, E, O1 and B. So once you get the center O1, you can draw a perpendicular line over here. Okay, so you will just draw a perpendicular line from the center O1. So once you draw a perpendicular line from the center O1, it will be easy for you to measure from O1 to E what is the distance and from O1 to B what is the distance. So once you measure the distance from O1 to E, so you will come back over here. Using the compass, you will just cut an arc on this perpendicular line. So you will get this corner E. Similarly, from O1 to B, you will measure what is the distance is using the compass. Keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc. So you will get the other corner, which is our B. So now we got all the corners of the base surface, right? If it is confusing, it's always better to do the naming immediately. So first you have fixed this edge, F and A you have named. So other corners also kindly name it. So this will be our B, C, D and E. The naming should be similar to the naming what you have done in the second stage. Only thing here, we are now inclining one of the edge to 30 degree to VP. So once this bottom surface is been done, right? So now we have to identify the apex. To identify the distance for the apex, we know the center and we have projected this line already. So now from the center O1 to O, you will measure what is the distance using the compass. So once you measure this distance using the compass, okay, so you will measure the distance and come back here from O1 and you will just cut an arc. So before cutting the arc, you can extend this perpendicular line little above. Just a second. Hello, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. After 5 minutes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I will send, sir. So, class admel parvagilva athva igle kalasla. Okay. Yes, sir. 10:30 I will send. Thank you, sir. Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry. There was an urgent call. Okay. So, once the base surface has been constructed, so from the center, we have this perpendicular line. We have this line constructed already. So this center line, you kindly extend backside. So after you extend this backside, you please measure from O1 to O, what is the distance? Okay, so after measuring O1 to O, keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc. So we got the apex O. So once apex O is obtained, now we can join the longer edges. So from O to E, as you have joined here, O to E, you will join over here. O to B, you will join. Okay. And we have the edge here, which is coming through inside the surface. B to O will be hidden and E to O will be hidden. And this edge of the bottom surface will be hidden. So once we construct the last stage top view, so we need to see how the final stage front view looks like. For that, we have to take the projection from each corners. So please take the projection from E, from D, from C, B, A, F, O1, and O. So after you take the projection from each corners, you know that we have to extend the projection from our front view also. So kindly take the projection from O1, from C1, O dash, C dash, D dash, O1 dash, B1 dash, E dash, and A1 dash, F dash. So where it meets now, you should identify the corners of the base. So for that, you will read the locus. So locus of A is meeting A dash at this point. So this is our A dash. Locus of B is meeting B dash at this point. So this is our B dash. Locus of C is meeting C dash at this point. So this is our C dash. Locus of D is meeting D dash at this point. So this is our D dash. Locus of E is meeting E dash at this point. So this is our E dash. Likewise, locus of F, we didn't tell. Locus of F is meeting F dash. So this is our F dash. After that, kindly read the locus for center. O1 is meeting O1 dash at this point. So this is our O1 dash. O is meeting O dash at this point. So this is our O dash, right? So after naming it, so now you have to join. So I told you once it has been named, always the outer boundary will be visible. So in the final front view, the observer will be viewing from here. So the bottom surface also will be entirely visible. Okay. So once we cover the outer boundary, then we'll go for the bottom surface. So after we name each and every corner, center of the base and the apex, kindly join the outer boundaries. So you will join A dash to B dash, B dash to O dash to D dash, D dash to E dash to F dash, F dash to A dash. So this is the outer boundary which is visible. We darkened it using continuous thick line. So once it has been darkened, so now what we have to do is, when the observer views from here, the bottom surface will be completely visible. So if it is inclined in this position, for XY line. So when the observer views from here, the bottom surface will be completely visible. And hence we will darken the bottom surface. Okay. So outer boundary we have joined already. So this part we have to now darken. D dash to C dash to B dash to A dash. So this is the outer boundary what we have to darken it. So once this has been darkened, so now you have to consider which are the hidden lines. So before going to the hidden lines, complete the visible lines first. So now we have joined the bottom surface and the outer boundary. So I have told you any projections coming through the corner of the bottom surface will be visible. So this is one corner of the bottom surface. This is one corner of the bottom surface. This is one corner of the bottom surface. So all these three will be visible. So this D dash to O dash is darkened already because it is of outer boundary. B dash to O dash is also darkened because this is of outer boundary. And this is not still darkened. So this is also one of the corner which is passing through the outer corner. So you will join C dash to O dash. Right, D dash to O dash, B dash to O dash. So all these are done. Apart from that, we have the longer edges which are passing through inside the surface also. So this is one of the edge which is passing through inside the surface. This is the other edge which is passing through inside the surface. And this is the third edge which is passing through inside the surface. So all these three will be hidden. So you will join E dash to O dash, F dash to O dash, A dash to O dash using hidden line because these projections are coming through inside the surface. Apart from that, the corners which is coming through outside the surface will be continuous line that we have done already. So once you show the hidden lines and the visible lines and you darken the outer boundaries, at the last, please don't forget to join the axis line. So here we have the projection of O1, which is here as O1 dash, and projection of O as O dash. So kindly join these two using axis line pattern or the center line pattern only. Don't show it as a hidden line and don't darken it also. Just draw it in the regular thickness of line what you use for projection line. So you can join O1 dash to O dash using light line, okay, not thick line. So this will complete the final stage of the front view. So this is how you have to solve the problem on hexagonal pyramid when it is resting on one of the edges. Okay, so if the same edge is inclined to VP, then this is how we will solve. If in the same problem, if it is told the axis is inclined to VP, then we have to determine the beta angle. So I will just explain you, just 2 seconds. Hello. Yeah. Okay. So now this was a regular problem on hexagonal pyramid. Similarly, we have the problem, same thing, same dimensions, only thing the axis is inclined here. And as a result, we have to determine the apparent angle. So here I will be just showing you the apparent angle construction. So remaining first and second is the same. So it is also an hexagonal pyramid of 25 mm side and 50 mm axis. It is inclined to 45 degree to HP. So the first stage and the second stage of the problem remains the same. Only the change part is related to our third stage. Why? Because the axis is inclined to VP at 30 degree. So in the previous problem, it was the edge which was inclined to 30 degree. But now it is the axis which has been inclined to 30 degree. So this will make a change in our third stage. So you will construct the true shape of the top view and the front view as I explained you in the first stage. And after that, you will construct the second stage similarly as I explained you by taking 45 degree to HP and then dropping down to get the second stage top view. So this will remain the same, what I told exactly in our last problem. So now, only in the last stage, after you complete the first and second stage, it is told that the axis is inclined to VP at 30 degree. So you know that the true length of the axis will be available in our first stage front view. But since in the second stage, the axis is inclined to some angle, the apparent length of the axis, the length of the axis what we get will be lesser than that of our true length. And hence, this distance is called as our apparent length. Since we don't get the true length in the second stage, whenever it is an axis inclination, we have to determine the apparent angle. In the same problem, if it was told the axis appears to be inclined to VP at 30, then we were not supposed to determine the beta angle. We used to directly shift the apparent length of the second stage to the third stage with respect to inclination of VP. So every time you have to read the question very carefully, whether it is appears to be or it is directly inclined. You have to see whenever it is a problem on axis inclination. So here directly being told that it is inclined to VP at 30. So we start up with the beta angle. So for the procedure to determine the beta angle remains the same irrespective of whether it's a prism or pyramid. Okay. But still you have to take the given inclination of VP. It is told 30 degree. So you can take either 30 degree this way or 30 degree this way based on your availability of the space. So once you take 30 degree, we know that always we have to take the true length of the axis. And the true length of the axis is 50 mm. So you measure 50 mm using the compass. Before measuring, first you fix the apex. Okay, don't fix the apex very near to XY line because you need to construct the entire pyramid. It should not come above XY line. So draw 30 degree line. After that, fix the apex little bit down below XY line. So once you fix the apex O, you measure this true length, how much it is. So it is 50 mm. So keep one end of the compost here, the other one here. So you'll get exactly 50 mm. So then come back to our 30 degree line and keep one end of the compost here and cut an arc on 30 degree line. So when you cut an arc, you will get the true length of the axis. So it is O2, O1. So please name this as O2, O1. Once you name O2, O1, this is our true length. So after you get name the O and O1, just draw the locus through O1. So you will draw the locus to O1, which will be parallel to our XY line. So once you draw the locus through O1, come back to the second stage and measure the apparent length. So the apparent length here is from O2 O1 in the second stage. So keep one end of the compass here and measure the distance O2 O1. Come back over here with the same fixed point O. You just cut an arc with the same distance what you have measured. You will measure the distance using compass. Keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc on the locus of O1. So it will meet somewhere. So where it meets, that is our O1 of apparent length. So you please name this as O1 and O. So this is our apparent length. So once you get this apparent length of the axis, you will extend this line towards our XY line. So when you extend, so inclination of the angle obtained will be our beta angle. So please measure how much it is. So here it has been shown as 45 degrees. So please draw a box and write beta is equal to 45 degrees. Okay. So that will help to identify the beta angle calculation. Sometimes what you write within the figure will not be visible also. So always draw a box and write the value of beta within it. So once you have determined the beta angle, so now we have to construct the remaining part. I told you how to construct the base of the hexagonal pyramid in the previous problem. Similarly, so now we have the axis. So once you have the axis, it is better to show these corners first. So what you do is you just take a construction line. You know the center, right? So from the center, you will just drop a perpendicular line. Okay, so as I shown you here, you'll just drop a perpendicular line. So this is our apparent length. So for this apparent length, this line will be exactly perpendicular. So once you draw this perpendicular line, you will measure from O1 to E what is the distance using the compass. So keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc. And similarly, from O1 to B, what is the distance you measure? Keep one end of the compass and cut an arc. So you will get E and B. So similarly, we have to do it for the other. So now what you will do is, so you know that D and M is coming along the same line. C and A is also coming along the same line. So you can identify from O1 to this point, what is the distance? O1 to this point, because at this midpoint, this line you can construct. So from O1 to this midpoint, what is the distance you will measure and just make a reference point over here. Okay, so from O1 to E, you will measure what is the distance. Keep one end of the compass and just make a reference point. Similarly, from O1 to this midpoint, what is the distance you measure? Keep one end of the compass here and make a reference point. So from these two reference points, you will draw the perpendicular lines. Okay, from this reference point, you will just... draw the perpendicular line. Similarly, here also. Okay, so from O1 to this point, you will make a reference point, and here also reference point. From the reference point, you will just draw a perpendicular line. You will just extend it. You will be not knowing until where you have to extend. You will just extend the perpendicular lines from these midpoints. You can see the construction line. Similarly, I have shown over here. After you draw this perpendicular line, so then you will measure from this midpoint to F what is the distance. Keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc on this perpendicular line. Similarly, from the midpoint to D, what is the distance you measure? and keep one end of the compass and cut an arc and again come back over here. So from midpoint to A, what is the distance you measure? Keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc. Similarly, from the midpoint to C, what is the distance you measure and cut an arc. So we got all the corners, right? So now you name it accordingly. It is D and C, it is F and A, it is E and B. So after that, please don't forget to identify the apex. So this apex is already fixed because it is beta angle. You know this is O. So no need of constructing this O. We have this already. And you know that outer boundary here is visible. So similarly, which are hidden lines, you will make here hidden. Which are visible lines, you will show that as visible lines. So these all corners, these all edges are visible. So show visible line E to D, D to C, C to B will be visible, and E to F will be hidden, F to A will be hidden, A to B will be hidden, and similarly from F to O also will be hidden, and A to O also will be hidden. So this is how you construct the third stage of the top view while determining beta angle if in case of axis inclination to VP. So once you have constructed this, you have to project the final view of a front view. So what we do is we will take the projection from each corner. So take the projection from D and O is very near. So see that you take the projection from D and not from O. O, this is the locus of O, what we have taken for the true length. Okay, so be careful. Take the projection from D, take the projection from E, from F, from A, from B, from C, and from O, and O1 also. So once you take the projection from all the points of the top view, kindly take the projection from the front view also. So we'll extend the projection from O1, C1 dash and D1, so C dash and D dash, O1 dash, B dash and E dash, A dash and F dash. So once you extend the projections, you have to start reading the locus. So now you see the locus of A is meeting A dash at this point. So this is our A dash. Then the locus of B is meeting B dash at this point. So this is our B dash. The locus of C is meeting C dash at this point. So this is our C dash. The locus of D is meeting D dash at this point. So this is our D dash. The locus of E is meeting E dash at this point. So this is our E dash. The locus of F is meeting F dash at this point. So this is our F dash. A dash we have shown, right? So after naming, we have to now join. So before joining, don't forget to take the projection from the center and the apex. So O1 is meeting O1 dash at this point. Name it as O1 dash. O is meeting O dash at this point, name it as O dash. So when the given inclination, when the given object has been inclined, right? When the observer views from here, the bottom surface will be continuous and visible line. So the bottom surface will be visible and the outer boundaries will be visible. So always we'll start up with joining the outer boundaries. So you will join A dash to B, you will join A dash to O dash, O dash to D dash, D dash to E dash, E dash to F dash, F dash to A dash. So this is the outer boundary of the given pyramid, which is visible. We darkened it. After that, when the observer views from here, this bottom surface will be visible. So the other three corners of the bottom surface, we will darken it. So you darken D dash to C dash, C dash to B dash, B dash to A dash. So now the outer, now the base surface is being darkened. So once the base surface is being darkened, see now which are the projections coming through the corners of the surface. So these are the corners, C dash and B dash. These two corners we have joined already with respect to outer boundary. So C dash to O dash will be visible. B dash to O dash also will be visible because these are the projection line which is coming from the outer surface. Okay. Similarly, we have the projections which is coming through inside the surface. So these projections will be hidden. So you will join E to O dash, E dash to O dash as hidden line, F dash to O dash as hidden line. So this is over. After that, sometimes you forget to show the access line. Please don't do it. You have marks for that also. So see that the projection of O1 and O, which is shown here as O1 dash and O dash, are joint using center line pattern, access line pattern. Okay, so kindly show the center line here from O1 dash to O dash. So this will help to get the final stage of the front view. When the given hexagonal pyramid is resting on one of its edge, where the axis is inclined to BP. So this is how you need to solve the problem when it is an beta angle. Okay, so same problem, if it is resting on one of its edge for VP inclination, we won't determine beta. So same problem, if it is an axis inclination, we have to determine the beta angle, right? So this is about the position of the hexagonal pyramid resting on one of its edge. Similarly, I'll just show you one more problem resting on one of its corner. Okay. The same thing, there are two problems. I will show the problem resting on one of its corner along with the beta angle calculation. This will be similar. The first and second stage will be similar. Only the thing in the last stage, it is appears to be inclined. And hence you won't determine the apparent angle. The only the apparent length you will be directly shifting to the 45 degree line. So this half part I can explain you after I complete this. Okay, so let us do the last problem for the day. So it is an hexagonal pyramid of 25 mm side of base and 50 mm axis, the same dimensions, right? But how it is resting? It is resting on one of its corner. So when it is told the given hexagonal pyramid is resting on one of its corner, so if this is our horizontal and vertical plane, you have to place the given pyramid in such a way that you are positioning the corner towards your right. So when you place the corner towards your right, by default, you'll be having the other corner opposite to the position where you have fixed, right? So you'll be having two corners opposite to each other. So in that case, when you view from the top, you will get a true shape of the surface of the hexagon as shown here, right, in the screen. So when you view from the top, you will get the bottom surface as our top view. This will be the true shape. And you know that bottom surface is named as A, B, C, D, E, and F. So the same naming, we will show it in our top view also. And always you should see when you have placed the given pyramid resting on one of its corner, the base edges will make equal inclinations with respect to HP. Okay. So if you are resting on one of its corner, the base edges will make equal inclinations with respect to our horizontal plane. That also should be satisfied. If you keep this somewhere in some inclined position, so that will not satisfy the need. That shows that it is not equally inclined to HP. You should always align the given pyramid in such a way it's making equal inclination with respect to our horizontal plane along with the position, both you have to check. So once that is being done, when you project from the top, I told you, you will have the shape of the hexagonal pyramid as shown here in the screen. And similarly, when you view here from the front, so here you will take the projection from this corner, projection from these two longer edges. Along with this, you will be able to show the axis line, right? The axis which is passing from the top of the apex to the bottom of the surface. Okay, so you will be having the center line which will be visible. So center line will be visible only when the given hexagonal pyramid is resting on one of its corner. If it is resting on one of its edge, then the axis will be overlapped with the longer edge as we seen in the last problem. Then you can't show the axis line. Whenever it is resting on one of its corner, you can show the axis line. In this case also, the front view will be a triangular surface only. Why? Because it is bounded with triangular surfaces. But here you will be having the projections extra because you can see when it is resting on one of its corner. Apart from this opposite corners, you can see the projection from these two longer edges. And one more we will be having. So if this is a problem, you will be having the projection from these two corners, the projection of these two longer edges. Then you view from the front. Apart from that, you will be having the center axis, which will be visible from the top to that of the bottom surface. So this is how you have to get the clarity, how it will be positioned when it is resting on one of its corner in case of hexagonal pyramid. Okay. So now you know that this is the true shape. How does it look like? So you have to show the corner here towards your right and not the edge. So how do you construct in this case? You will just draw an horizontal line. Leave some space below XY line. Don't start very near to XY line because you need to construct the entire hexagon. So leave some enough space below XY line and then draw the horizontal line. Once you draw the horizontal line, see what is the side of the given pyramid. It is 25 mm. So using scale, you can mark 25 mm on it or use compass and just measure 25 mm. So once you measure 25 mm, then you can either take the exterior angle or interior. So if you're going with interior angle, you will take 120 degree. So this way, and again 120 degree this way also. So you'll get the other two sides, but you have to fix the dimension for the side. So you will measure 25 mm, keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc. Similarly, here also you have taken 120 degree. Right, so you have this line already. On this you will measure 25 mm and you will cut an arc. So after that you can take again from this point 120 degree, so you will get this side. 120 degree interior angle, you will get this side. Take 25 mm and cut an arc. Take 25 mm and cut an arc and join all the corners. Darken it immediately. Okay. And when you view from the top, all the bottom surface will be visible. So you will write it as A, B, C, D, E, and F. And in all the solids, you know that you have to join the diagonals to show the center. So please join the diagonals here. You will identify the center. So when you view from the top center O will be visible and the bottom center O1 will not be visible. So when you view from the top. So O you will write outside the bracket, O1 you will write within the bracket. So we'll name it as O and O1. Please show the dimension of at least one side of the given surface. Okay. So you can show either to this side as 25 mm, this side to 25 mm or the bottom, whichever is convenient to you. So once you complete the top view in all means, you will take the projection above. So once you take the projection above, so just may take the projection from D, C and E will be along the same line, B and F will be along the same line, A will be along the same line, okay? And the center line also you will project. Keep everything on XY line. So once you do with XY line, so now you measure the axis distance, how much it is. It is 50 mm. Just a second, I have a link to be shared. Okay. So after you take the projections on XY line, so from the center you measure the axis height and use the center line pattern only. So you will draw the center line pattern. So it will show 50 mm. So please draw the center line until 50 mm. Okay. Or else you blindly draw the center line, measure 50 mm in the compass and just cut an arc, whichever is convenient to you. Then name it as O dash immediately. Then you will join from O dash to this corner, O dash to this corner, and again from O dash to this point, O dash to this point, right? And the axis will be of center line pattern. So once this is done, please read from the bottom. So here the projection of D will be visible and hence you will write it as D dash when the observer views from the bottom. So here when the observer views from the bottom, C and E will be along the same line. C will be visible and E will be hidden. So you will write C dash outside the bracket, E dash within the bracket. And when the observer views from here, the center will not be visible. So we'll write it as O1 dash. Okay. And here B and F will be along the same line. And the observer views from here, B will be visible and F won't be visible. So we'll write it as B dash and f dash within the bracket. So when the observer views from here, a will be visible. So we'll write it as a dash. So o1 dash, it is not visible, and hence we have written o1 dash here, and o will be visible, and hence you will write this as o dash. So this is done. So after that, it is told that the axis is inclined to HP at 40 degree. So you will leave some space and draw the axis line. So once you draw the axis line, right, you have to now construct the front view, which was vertical upright position to the inclined angle. So you take 45 degree to HP. So after that, you please measure this distance, because now the base is parallel to XY line. So now you have to shift such that it is lying on one of its corner on the XY plane. So what we do is we will measure from O1 dash to A dash. What is the distance? After you measure this distance using the compass, just move on this axis line until that distance cuts on our XY line. So we'll be having this reference point and where it has been cutting. Right, so these two you will join immediately. So this is half part of the base. So you will name this as O1 dash, and this is as our A dash. So this base half part is done. So then you will extend the same baseline on the opposite end. After you extend the line, you see that the entire base is perpendicular to our 45 degree line. If that is so, then we can construct the remaining part. So from the center to D dash, you measure what is the distance. Come back over here and just cut an arc on the baseline what you have extended. So we got both the corners of the base. So this is the D dash and this is A dash. And remaining distance you please measure. From O1 dash to C1 dash, what is the distance you measure? And just make a reference point. And similarly, from O1 dash to B1 dash, what is the distance you measure? One end of the compass here and just make a reference point. Okay, so name it accordingly. It is C1 dash and E1 dash. It is B1 dash and F1 dash. Similarly to what we have named over here. So the horizontal base is now inclined here to particular angle. So after shifting the base, now you should see what is the axis height. We have drawn this 45 degree line. Right, so axis height is 50 mm. So measure 50 mm, keep one end of the compass here and just cut an arc on this axis line. Okay, where it cuts, it will be our O dash. So from O dash to D dash you join, from O dash to C dash you join, from O dash to center O1 dash you join, from O dash to B dash you join, from O dash to A dash. So all these are visible lines, so please do it accordingly. So once you shift the given front view from perpendicular axis to inclination of HP at 45, then you have to take the projections down. So please take the projections from D, from each and every point. Okay, so from D dash, C dash, B dash, A dash, O dash, O1 dash. Okay, so you take the projection from each and every point of our front view. After that, kindly take the projections from the top view as well. E and F will be along same line. D and A will be along same line. C and B will be along same line. Along with that, take the projection of D and A. In that, you will be having the center also coming along the same line. So once you draw the projection lines, you should start reading the locus. First, always construct the bottom surface, then go for the center and the apex. So start reading the locus of the bottom surface. So this is the locus of A, this meeting A dash at this point. So this will be our A. Locus of F will be meeting F dash at this point. So this is our F. Locus of E will be meeting E dash at this point. So this is our E. Locus of D will be meeting D dash at this point. So this is our D. Locus of C will be meeting C dash at this point. So this is our C. Locus of B will be meeting B dash at this point. So this is our B. So we got all the corners of the bottom surface. So once you are done with this, take the projection of O and O1. Okay, so the projection of O is meeting O dash at this point. So this is our O. The projection of O1 is meeting O1 dash at this point. So this is our O1. Okay. So after that, I told you when the given pyramid, hexagonal pyramid is inclined to 45 degree to VP, right? So when the observer views from the top in this way, the entire outer boundary will be visible. And hence you will join the outer boundary of the given solid first. So you will join from O to B, B to C, C to D, D to E, E to F and F to O. So this is the outer boundary of the solid which will be visible. And you have one corner here on XY line. So if you have one corner resting on XY line here, the projection coming through that line will be always hidden. So here you can see through A dash. A dash is the projection of A dash is hidden. Right, so when it comes, so you have two sides or the edges which is coming through the corner A. So these two edges will be hidden. So A to F will be hidden and A to B will be hidden because this corner is on XY line. So the corner which is on XY line, the projection coming out through it will be hidden. So that we are done. And the bottom surface, the other sides and the edges are already done. And outer boundary we have joined. Right, and apart from that we have the two corners here, which is I have told you the projection coming through the corner of the surface will be visible. So you will, and it is outer boundary, so this is E to O, it will be visible. So please draw continuous thick line, and from D to O also it will be visible and continuous thick line. C to O also it will be visible and it will be continuous and thick line. Right, so this is how you have to construct the second stage of the top view in case of hexagonal pyramid which is resting on one of its corners. So now only you can notice this is the true length of the axis. Since it has been inclined, the axis length what we are getting here in the second stage is lesser than it. If you can measure, you can see that it is 38.3, whereas the true length is 50 mm. Since you have the variation in the true length and the apparent length, we need to determine the apparent angle whenever it is told the axis is inclined to VP. So in this stage, we have now completed first and second. And in the third stage, it is told that the axis is inclined. The axis of the pyramid is inclined to VP at 30 degree. Since the true length is not available in the second stage, the only option is to determine the apparent angle and then reconstruct the second stage top view to the third stage. So the procedure again is the same. You know how to construct it. Just a second. Yeah. So what we do is we will just take 30 degree to VP first. So once we take, this is a 30 degree line, 30 degree to VP. After taking 30 degree to VP, you have to now check what is the true length of the axis. So the true length of the axis here is 50 mm. So before measuring, after taking 30 degree, leave some space and then fix the apex. So here the apex is our O. Right, so you will fix O. So once you fix O, you measure the true length of it, how much it is. From O to O1, it is 50 mm. Measure using the compass. Keep one end of the compass at the fixed end and just cut an arc on the 30 degree line. So where it meets will be our O1. Okay, so from there you just draw the locus. So after drawing the locus, come back to the second stage and measure the distance from O to O1, what it is. Okay, so it is exactly 38.3. So measure that distance from the same fixed point. You will cut an arc on the locus of the O1. Okay, so where it meets will be our O1 of the apparent length. So you will join this O to O1 immediately. So please join the apparent length from O to O1 immediately. It is visible line, so please make it an visible thick line. So once you do with the apparent length, extend this line to our XY plane. So when you extend this line to xy plane, we'll come to know what is the beta angle. Always the beta angle will be more than that of the inclination angle to VP, which has been given. Okay, so you please measure right within the box beta is equal to how much you are getting. Okay, so once you calculate the apparent angle, so now we have to reshift the problem from the second stage to that of the third stage. All the hidden and visible line which was there in the second stage, same thing you have to replicate. Don't make any changes even in the naming. So once you draw this apparent length, so now you think about how to reconstruct the remaining part of the given pyramid. So we now know O1 to O. So if you extend this apparent length little bit backside, you will get one corner here of the bottom surface. So we have the distance from O1 to O. So you measure the distance from O1 to D, what it is, extend this line, keep one end of the compass and cut an arc. So you'll get the point D, because D, O1, A and O all are along the same line, so that we got at least one of the longer edge shifted to the apparent angle. So after doing this, construct the bottom surface first. So you can see here, E and C is along the same line, F and B is along the same line. So you need to know the distance between D to this point. So this will be exactly half from the center. So this is O1 and D. So this will be exactly half. So from between O1 and D, you identify the center point. So from the center point, as I'm showing you, you just draw a perpendicular line. Right? Perpendicular line. Between this O1 and D, the midpoint what you have, you just identify the midpoint and draw the perpendicular line. Similarly, identify the midpoint of the other edge. From O1 to A, you identify the midpoint, keep one end of the compass here, measure the distance, come here and just make a reference point. So from that reference point, you just draw the perpendicular line. So you will identify two perpendicular lines as I have drawn here. So once you draw this perpendicular lines, you will measure the distance from this midpoint to E. What is the distance? Okay, please measure this distance, come back over here and just cut an arc. Similarly, from the midpoint to C, you measure what is the distance is, come back here, and from the same midpoint you just cut an arc on the perpendicular line. So now we got the two corners E and C. So this is our E and this is our C. Similarly, now you have identified the midpoint and drawn the perpendicular line also. So from this midpoint to F, you measure what is the distance is using the compass. Keep one end of the compass here and cut an arc. So you'll get F. Similarly, from this midpoint, you measure the distance B, how much it is. Keep one end of the compass here and cut an arc. So you will get F and B. And D you have got. And this corner A, you please measure from the center to A, what is this distance? From O1 to A, what is the distance? Using compass, keep one end of the compass over here and just cut an arc. So you will get A. So after getting A, that shows that you have now identified all the six corners and the center O1. You need to identify the apex O. Even in this case, O is fixed already. So now you know all the corners and outer boundary will be visible. So join all the boundaries first. Okay, so it is A. Yeah. So you can join the outer boundaries. It is O to B, B to C, C to D, D to E, E to F, F to O. And you see here which are the edges hidden in the second stage. So the edges F and A was hidden and B and A was hidden. Same thing, you show it hidden over here. And E to O was dark continuous line. Make this dark. E to O, C to O was also dark. So darken this C to O as well. And D to O, the longer edge also was visible. So please darken it from D to O. So this will cover our third stage top view, where we have shifted the apparent length to the apparent angle inclination. So once this is done, now we have to identify, and for cross-checking, once you construct, you just measure the apparent length, how much you are getting in the third stage. The value of the apparent length, what you're getting in third stage, and the value of the apparent length, what you have obtained in the second stage top view should be the same. Okay. So after doing the cross-checking, kindly take the projections from each and every corner and point from the top view. Okay, towards our front view. So please take the projection from E, D, F, A, C, B, O, and O1. After you do this, extend the projection from O dash, D dash, C dash, O1 dash, B1 dash, and A1 dash as shown here. So after this, what we do is you will read the locus. So please read the locus. So where is our point A? It is here. So the locus of A is meeting A1 dash at this point. So this is our A dash. Locus of B is meeting B dash at this point. So this is our B dash. Locus of F is meeting F dash at this point. So this is our F dash. Locus of E is meeting E dash at this point. So this is our E dash. Locus of D is meeting D dash at this point. This is our D dash. Locus of C is meeting C dash at this point. So this is our C dash. So we name the bottom surface. After naming the bottom surface, please do name the center from the bottom surface as well as from the apex. So O1 dash is meeting O dash here. So this is our O dash. O is meeting O dash over here. So this is our O dash. Okay. So after that, I told you, the outer boundary will be visible. So please join the outer boundary first. So we have A dash to B dash, B dash to O dash to D dash to E dash to F dash, and F dash to A dash. So this is the outer boundary. And when the observer views from here, the bottom surface will be visible. So please complete the bottom surface. We have joined the bottom surface here already, so only these two edges to be darkened. So you will dark D1 to C1 and C1 to B1, because the entire bottom surface will be visible when the observer views from here. After that, I told you that the projection coming through the corners of the surface will be visible. So this we have joined already as a part of outer boundary. This also we have joined already as a part of outer boundary. And this corner C is visible. So you please join the projection from C dash to O dash. It will be visible. Apart from that, we have three corners through which the projections are passing through inside the surface. So those projections will be hidden. So these are the longer edges, E dash and O dash, which is passing through inside the surface. And hence it is hidden. And again, A dash to O dash, it is passing through inside the bottom surface, and hence it is hidden. Along with that, we have one more corner, F dash to O dash, which is passing through inside the surface, and hence that will be hidden. Okay. Along with that, you have the corner C dash to O dash, which is visible. So even the visible line should be shown, and the hidden line passing beside it also to be shown properly. Right. So please construct properly. Take the projection lines parallel so that you won't go wrong in naming. If you go wrong in naming, then the shape of the final stage, how does it look, will be varied. By looking at that only, we can identify whether you have constructed properly or not. So be careful in constructing cut-to-cut dimensions from stage 2 to stage 3. If you go wrong in taking proper measurements, you will end up with a wrong image. Okay, so this is how you have to construct the problem when it is resting on one of its corner and axis is directly inclined to VP. Similarly, you can do this. I'm not going to tell you. I'll share the videos later to you all. Okay, so this is the same problem resting on one of its corner. So stage 1 and stage 2 will be the same as I explained you right now. Only thing is here, the axis appears to be inclined to VP. Since it appears to be inclined to VP, we won't determine the beta angle. This stage will be very simple to you. What you do is, You will just take what is the axis inclination. You will see it is 45 degree to VP. So please take 45 degree line. You know this is the apparent length of the second stage. Kindly shift the apparent length from O to O1 on 45 degree line first. You know the other formalities. You have to leave some space, fix the point O. Then from O to O1, you will measure the axis distance. So after you measure the axis distance, then you will reconstruct the entire second stage to the third stage. How did I explain over here? The same procedure. Only thing is beta angle will be not there. You will just shift the apparent length directly to 45 degree line. And once you get this apparent length, you will extend this line as I told you in the previous problem. So we'll get this corner. Then you will identify the midpoint here, identify the midpoint here, draw the perpendicular line, draw the perpendicular line, measure this distance and cut an arc, get the bottom surface, then extend this apparent length line. This is already extended. You'll be knowing the apex O. So join the outer boundaries. It will be really simple because no beta angle. Then you'll take the projections, okay, from the top view as well as the front view. Show the outer boundaries, visible line, a projection coming through the corner of the surface will be visible. So please show it as darker line. Same thing, it looks the same. See, you can see the same concept which is being shown here. The image of the final view also looks the same. Only thing, no beta angle. Okay, so this is how you have to solve the problems on hexagonal pyramid. So I will be posting the questions based on the hexagonal pyramid in the Google Classroom by the end of the day, right? So you please see that you will submit. Oh, those who haven't submitted the pending works, kindly do it. And others of today's problems, you can just upload back in the Google Classroom. We have less time, so please see that you keep on updating your documents in the Google Classroom so that I can evaluate and resend you back. Okay, so if you have any doubts, you can ask. And for the test, the portion is the same. Question bank is given. Please practice well. You see that you solve the problems and upload back to the Google Classroom. That will be a part of your practice for your internals. So once you practice, it will not help you to solve the problem in less period of time. Perfection comes with respect to more number of practicing. So you see that you solve the problems in the sketchbook and upload it. So that will help you for the test as well as for your sketchbook completion. Okay. Mohammed. Hello. Yeah. So kindly inform the others. I will just post the message. I cannot see two, three students over
yes,
here.
Ma'am.
Yeah, Mohammed. Praneet is here.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Praneet, you just inform for the students, those who are not here currently, around 2 to 3 students who haven't, that we will be having the internals on Friday afternoon. I will post in the WhatsApp group also. Please communicate in your students group as well. The portions also, you know exactly what is it. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay,
yeah,
ma'am.
Yeah, and please keep all your belongings ready, the sketchbook, the sheets of the sketchbook, if you have extra, or any blank sheets if it is not there, keep everything ready. So we will be having the regular class on the morning session, and in the afternoon we'll be conducting the class. So in the next class we will be solving problems on slant edges, right? So that will be helpful for us to cover the portion on projection of solids. Fine. If anyone have not written your name and USN still, kindly type it on. Jayant is here. Hello. Okay. Namrata?
Yes, ma'am.
Rajwal? Okay. Makara?
Me, ma'am.
Yeah. See that all of you kindly submit, or many of you have not submitted the problems of the last class. Okay, I have posted the questions, so see that you do submit it. I knew that you people had internals, so I didn't force you now. Only on Sunday, only I just posted a message to upload the pending problems. Fine. So if you practice, that will be helpful for your internals as well. See that you do it. Navya?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. How many part are pending at your side?
Ma'am, the prisms are done, ma'am. The other ones which you posted recently are not done yet.
Yeah, please do it. I have posted with the due dates also. Okay, so kindly submit.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, fine then. So take care. So we'll meet on Friday with the slant edge problems. Bye-bye and take care. If anyone have not written your name and USN, still kindly do add on in the chat room. Okay then, thank you so much and all the best for your internals. We'll be back on Friday morning to the class. Take care and bye-bye. Okay.